Like a chrysalis, we're emerging from the economy of the Industrial Revolution. An economy confined to and limited by the Earth's physical resources, into the economy in mind, in which there are no bounds on human imagination, and the freedom to create is the most precious natural resource.
Welcome to the Soul of Enterprise, Business, and the Knowledge Economy. I'm Ron Baker, along with my good friend and Verisage Institute colleague, Ed Kless. On today's show, folks, we're going to talk about, I can't believe I'm doing this, project management insights from D-Day. Ed, I can't believe you signed off on this crazy wacko idea.
Your idea, so self-inflicted ballistic podiatry, my friend, if you wanted to talk about project management. Okay. If you're sure.
Just give me the rope. Let me hang myself. Great. Excellent. Well, it was inspired by this article, Ed, out of National Review. And I don't even think it's in the June issue, which I don't even think is out yet, or at least I haven't got my copy. But sometimes they release them early online. And this is by Andrew Roberts. Now, Andrew Roberts is a British historian who has written multiple volumes on Churchill. He's written on Napoleon, I think. He's written on the King George III. Mm-hmm. He wrote a very flattering biography. I don't know if you remember that. He did the interview with Peter Robinson. He's fantastic historian, fantastic writer. And he wrote this article, D-Day at 80, because we're coming up on its 80th anniversary, June 6, 1944, How the Allies Won at Normandy and Changed History. And it was just a great article. And as I was reading it, I just kept hearing you in the background with all those project management terms about scope and certainty and risk and assumptions and assignment of responsibilities and all of these different things. And I know you've always said that you always show a picture of Eisenhower as the best project manager of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. And this article confirms it. So I just thought it would be kind of fun to go through it and try and bring it down to project management and maybe and talk a little bit about strategy as well, because it's obviously one of the best strategies.
Yeah, both those topics are prevalent in this article, strategy and pricing. I'm sorry, strategy and project management. And so I thought it was real good. But yeah, Ron, let's just kind of go through the article just as the way it's presented. I really like the format. It takes it hour by hour. So, you know, D-Day, of course, was a code for the D-Day, the day that it was supposed to be, and H-hour, right, which is the first hour of this. So he goes using the military time, you know, 02:15 is when more than 68,000 vessels were spotted by Germans, and takes it from there. But I like really the format that he takes us through, and it's really a time sequence of everything that happens. And just what were your reactions to that, the presentation, Ron? I thought that was really good.
Oh, I thought it was brilliant, because, you know, when you write an article, you obviously have to just give the essence of it. And I just thought he did a great job summarizing it. There's so much more to this story, but some of the highlights for me was under 0300, he talks about the Luftwaffe. They flew 319 sorties over Normandy that day. The Allies flew 13,688. In all, some 11,500 Allied warplanes of various types took part in D-Day. Only four were shot down. All I can say is, thank heavens the Germans didn't have more air cover. Because like he points out somewhere in the article, he says, if an Allied soldier looked up in the sky, there was a 99.9% chance it was one of their planes.
Not true. I actually did the math. It was okay. 319 over 13,688 is about 2%. It was only a 98% chance. 98%
chance. Okay. Okay, still pretty good.
Pretty good.
That's what struck me. The other thing that struck me was Adolf Hitler went to bed, and he told, and he was not even told about the events in Normandy, as his orderly had strict orders not to wake him until the next morning. He was fast asleep when the Armada arrived. off the coast of Normandy. And it reminded me of a quote from Dean Rusk. He was Secretary of State under Johnson, I believe Kennedy as well. He said, only one third of the world is asleep anytime. The other two thirds are up to something.
And certainly the Allies were up to something. Yeah, I thought that was fascinating, too. I mean, Hitler was a teetotaler, so he wasn't up late drinking the night before. But yeah, he was up chatting with like some ambassador from one of the republics that were in under the influence and of Germany. And he goes to bed late and says, hey, don't I'm not to be disturbed no matter what. And I guess it wasn't until Albert Speer showed up and said, no, I really think we should wake him up. Like, I think this might kind of be important.
And the great thing is the poor generals that learned about the attack before Hitler did, they couldn't release like the Panzer tanks and other weaponry and, other soldiers because they needed permission. They didn't have the authority.
Mm-hmm.
So the lines of command weren't clear. And that was another thing that rung from your project management talks.
Yeah.
There's got to be clear lines of responsibility and accountability.
Correct. And there has to be one project manager. Project management is not a team sport. There's got to be one person ultimately who's responsible. And of course, on the other side, we had General Eisenhower, who at that point was the supreme Allied commander. And you got to think that the personalities that he had to manage over there, I mean, certainly, and we'll talk more about this because the story involves Patton, Montgomery, who was a very strong personality in and of himself. Of course, Curtis LeMay, who actually dies as part of this story. Lots and lots of strong personalities, not to mention Churchill and Roosevelt.
Omar Bradley he talks about it. 0400, the moment when the troops climbed off the ships and onto the 3,000 specially designed landing craft. And Ed, these things were built at the Higgins Dockyards in New Orleans. And if you ever go to the New Orleans World War II Museum, the first thing when you walk in is one of these landing crafts.
Yes,
and that is a great museum to hit. And then he talks about, for all the public optimism, several senior figures had severe reservations about D-Day. It may well be the most ghastly disaster of the whole war, General Sir Alan Brooke, the chairman of the British Chief of Staff, thought.
Mm-hmm.
And even Churchill said, I see the channel being full of corpses of defeated allies. He said that in 1943. Eisenhower, He had reservations about it too, and he put a letter in his pocket just in case the invasion failed. And the letter read, our landings in the Jubarhov area have failed to gain a satisfactory foothold, and I have withdrawn the troops. My decision to attack at this time and place was based on the best information available. The troops, the air, and the Navy did all that bravery and devotion to duty could do. If any blame or fault attaches to the attempt, it is mine alone.
Yeah, just like all of our politicians today, Ron, it's amazing how much how Eisenhower has really inspired generations of people in leadership positions across all countries who basically say, look, if it's something goes wrong, it's on me. I'm the one to blame. It's so good that we've learned these lessons, Ron. So good.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. Rather than just giving a milquetoast apology, I'm sorry. No, take accountability and get fired or resign or, whatever. But
it's not. I'm sorry. It's not my fault. And if it was my fault, see rule one, it was not my fault.
The other thing, Ed, that I thought was really interesting was he talked about the 29 tanks launched into the channel for Omaha Beach. No fewer than 27 sank. Mm-hmm. Only two got ashore. One guy did samples of the beach ahead of time, and he said, this doesn't look good for the tanks. This also reminds me the number of men that they sent and, of course, the waves of troops that came after. There's this great thing in the military called tooth-to-tail ratio where they talk about the number of support personnel to support the front lines. That's the tail, the front lines, or the tooth. And the numbers in here later on, but didn't something like 200,000 come after that first wave and in the following month?
I think they landed over 100,000. It's toward the end of the story, Ron. They landed over 100,000 on D-Day, and then 2 million.
2 million. That's right. So I'm
2 million following the coming months. So,
They landed 156,000 and 2 million following the next 3 months. That's the tooth to tail ratio.
Right, right. But I mean, okay, so just want to take yourself through this. I did some checking on this. The Long Island Railroad, which I happened to, when I was going into the city, roughly 250,000 people go into and out of Manhattan on the Long Island Railroad every day. Okay. So, which is 250,000. And that's in a train. In a nice, air conditioned, comforting surroundings, Wi-Fi with a track that's been laid there for decades. And logistics behind that are amazing. That they 250,000 into and out of Manhattan every single day. That's pretty amazing. Okay. They land over 150,000 people in a single day on a beach. Are you serious? While getting shot at the whole time?
I know. And the planners had anticipated 20,000 would be killed. Now, 3,000 French people did die on D-Day, mostly from liberators' bombs and shells rather than the Germans. And in all, around 20,000 civilians were killed during the Normandy campaign. But in terms of Allied soldiers, it was 4,572. And he even gives a breakdown between the Americans and the British and the Canadians and the New Zealanders and all that. But only 4,572 were killed rather than the 20,000 they were anticipating.
Right. Yeah. No, it's pretty amazing.
And then what else? The other thing that struck me was just the decoy operation that they set up.
Yep.
Was incredible.
Yeah, and I had forgotten that Patton was in charge of that, but I have actually told that story when I talk about project management, because that's one of the real interesting things. But what I thought was interesting is, like, they made a big flourish about it, right? They made sure that everyone knew that Patton was there. So, and Hitler's thinking, there's no way that they're going to do this without Patton.
Patton, that's right. Yep.
So the invasion of Calais, but we'll get there. We get ahead of ourselves. Ron, I think let's take our first break here, because want to make sure we give this the not the short shrift and really go into some details. And I'm going to kind of start at the top again and talk about from a project management perspective and maybe add a little color to it as well. But want to remind our listeners that they can get a hold of Ron or me by sending an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Of course, the website is The Soul of Enterprise, where you can see show notes as well as previews to upcoming shows. We want to talk on when we return about what we're participating in, or what I'm participating in with Reframe 2024, but we'll talk about after we hear from our sponsors. Well, that's us, actually.
Voice America is on LinkedIn. Connect with us today.
Are you a fan of The Soul of Enterprise? Have you always wanted to demonstrate you could create a commercial that was better than what Greg Kite developed? Well, now is your chance. Ed, tell them all about it.
Ron and I are actively looking for new sponsors for The Soul of Enterprise, and we have big plans to grow the show. To learn more, send us an email to asktsoe@verisage.com and put sponsor in the subject line, and we'll send you over our latest sponsor pack. We would love for you to be part of the TSOE team.
Have you ever read a book that changed your life? I sure have. Have you ever listened to an advertisement for a book so many times that you question the existence of God? Me too. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. I recorded the advertisement for Ron and Ed's book, The Soul of Enterprise Dialogues on Blah 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 Whatever, and 4 years later, we're all tired of it, especially me. But thankfully, there's a solution. For just $10 a month, you never have to hear my voice again. For a commercial-free version of The Soul of Enterprise, go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe now.
The reviews of Ron Baker and Paul Dunn's book Time's Up are in, and they are outstanding. AC says, I highly recommend this book to others in my field and beyond. Britta L. says, I was even awake at 3 a.m. one morning, filled with all the amazing ideas swirling in my head. And some guy named Greg T. added, do not consider transitioning your business to a subscription model until you've read this book. Head over to timesupclub.com, click on the book to purchase it, and while you're there, why not join at the free forever level and get access to some extras? Do it now. You'll be glad you did.
Stimulating talk.
It gets those synapses in the brain firing really fast.
All the time. The number one internet talk station where your opinion counts. VoiceAmerica.com.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
And we are back on The Soul of Enterprise. We were talking about D-Day at 80, how the Allies won Normandy and changed history. But Ron, before we get there, I just want to mention a conference that I'm going to be speaking at, and I know that you spoke at last year, and that is Reframe 2024. Hector and his team have been a big boon to The Soul of Enterprise. We're happy for their friendship. But I want to talk about this unique conference for accounting professionals that want to improve their communication skills and better communicate their value for influential conversations for their clients and employees. You spoke, as I said, at 2023. Thought it was great. And I'm going to be there in October of 2024. If you want more information about this, use the coupon code TSOE for a 25% off preferred price through June, through the end of June. And that's reframe2024.com. All right, Ron, so back to this. And just one quick correction. This is from the July issue of National Review. It is online now. The dateline is May 16th, 2024. Let's not talk about the vestiges of publishing and why we're seeing an article that's from the July issue that was published in May. But okay, you know, that's online today, you know, so go figure. But yeah, so there's a lot here, and just to jump into one of the things, and this is in the 0215 section, and where he says this one depended on success for a single day's finding. The planners described it as a satisfactory foothold that must have been gained by nightfall. It very likely would not be gained. And I think that that's significant. This notion of a satisfactory hookup. Yes, it's subjective. But what was very objective about it is that they had to do it by nightfall or it would not have been gained. So they were going to make a decision on that at nightfall, and they pre-made that decision ahead of time. This is part of what is called contingency planning, where you actually have a specific contingency in place that says, if this happens, this is what we're going to do. And I was talking about this with my mentor, Howard, today, and he read the article, too, and was very much impressed by what went on and how most of this did not go according to plan. I've heard things like only 20% of D-Day did not go according to plan, but 80% of the objectives were met. I actually question that. I think it's a nice 80-20 thing to it. I don't know if it was necessarily 80%, but certainly the main objective was obtained. But one of the things that he said, and this is based on the work that he did, Howard was in the military back in Vietnam era and worked for a general. I believe his chief of staff. And he said, you know, he saw on numerous occasions people would come to the general and said, you know, we got this one plan, the general. It's all we 90% success factor. We've got all of our contingency plans figured out. If this is going to happen, if this is going to happen. And he says his general usually had one response. Bull. Right. This is like horse hockey. Sure. Like Colonel Potter. He said, it goes according to the plan. But this general, and of course, what Eisenhower knew, it is the act of planning that is important, not the plan itself. And this, of course, leads to the very famous quote, which was not in this article, but that is attributed to Eisenhower, that planning is essential. Plans are worthless.
Right.
Planning is essential. Plans are worthless.
You know, I also went back and looked at Donald Rumsfeld's book. He's got a book on Rumsfeld rules for leadership lessons in business, politics, war, and life. And he said the paradox of planning is no strategy will be executed as originally conceived. the challenge of the unexpected. And he quotes Carl von Clausewitz, who said, "The unexpected is the prince of the battlefield."
Mm-hmm.
That's brilliant.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, and, that is absolutely brilliant.
And he says, "What you see is what you get. What you don't see gets you."
Mm-hmm.
The unknown unknowns.
Yes, yes. Yeah, and we'll talk about some of those because they actually do come up in this. I do like the swipe that this is from Churchill, where he says that the fools or knaves who have chalked second front now on our walls for the past 2 years, had not their minds been burdened by such problems, I had long pondered upon them. That's a swipe at Stalin. Right.
Yep.
who is saying second front now, back in 1942.
Yep.
That's right. Yeah. I was like, yeah, no, not going to do that. but you got to remember, Stalin looked at it very differently, right? Throw men into the grinder. That was.
Sure.
That's the plan.
That's what they did. That's what the Russians did.
That's what the Russians did. Just throw guys in the ground, Whereas Churchill had learned from Gallipoli that he was a part of, that was back in World War II, and that was a disaster. And then several landings that took place during the Italian invasion that were messy, and they learned a lot from the disasters that happened as part of that invasion. And that was another ground landing invasion, a little bit different than a specific, very targeted space like they did in Normandy. But, Churchill had already seen the failure, right? Churchill had already seen the failure. There was something in here. We'll get back to this because I think there's an echo in this of this later in the piece. But I was thinking about this. And then what kept coming to my mind is, what about Taiwan?
Hmm. Hmm. Because that's amphibious too.
It will be, and not as much. And you would wonder if the Chinese were ever to invade, how would they do it? Would they try to do bombardment first and bombard the heck out of it before they started landing any troops? But at some point,
if you want boots on the ground,
you get to get boots on the ground, right? So, but yeah, I thought that was pretty interesting. I hadn't thought about this, but this is an interesting paragraph. If D-Day had failed, it would have postponed the liberation of Europe by at least a year, with the Germans developing new weaponry. And, we all worry about that. Who knows what would have happened? But I hadn't thought about this, that if the Russians had destroyed the if we hadn't landed and the Russians had continued to destroy the German armies on their way through, nothing would have prevented most of Western Europe, perhaps even as far as Paris, from falling under Stalin's communist grip. I hadn't thought about that side of it too.
Yeah, that was an interesting what if point.
yeah, talking about alternate history, right? That you could take that.
Ed, any comment about how long they planned for this? This was like a multi-year plan.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. The
starting in 1942. Yeah.
Just the duration of the planning is impressive.
Right. Well, 2+ years of planning for one day, which is always one of the things that I point out when I'm talking about this, is like, planning is if you do proper planning, it's going to take a much longer time than you feel comfortable with. I'm saying, like, when someone says to me, "All right, Ed, enough with the planning. I think we're done with the planning." I'm like, "Nope, that means we're halfway." When you're sick about it, I'm like, "I don't want to talk about this anymore." Then I know we're halfway there.
That's very interesting. That's like the education that you should give your people before you turn them loose.
Mm-hmm.
Right. A lot of firms, it's like a week, maybe two. I think I had 2 weeks of orientation at Pete Marwick before they threw me out. It doesn't seem like enough.
No, it's not. It's not. I mean, think about what Disney does and some of the other great companies that container store. You have to work your way up and work in the stores all before you even take a management role. I mean, Container Store had this famous policy. I think you had to work in a store for 2 months before you took on like the controllership role. Like, they made everybody work the retail side of it. before you moved up. And I think that's a brilliant, and everybody, for a while, everybody at corporate had to do at least 2 weeks in a store every year.
Mm. Yeah. I think Southwest does that too. They rotate people around in different jobs. Mm-hmm. So everybody gets a sense of what everybody else has to do and what their frustrations are.
Yeah. So, but a quick side note here, and this is, they said that you brought up the sorties that day, right? And 11,500 Allied warplanes took place, and only four were shot down. Four. Which leads me to this conclusion. I bet more were lost due to mechanical failure. Like, of 11,500 planes during World War II, I guarantee you that more than four of them fell out of the sky for no reason, not even being hit by Germans.
Yeah. Oh, it's very possible.
Yep. All right. So here it is. Yes, it was the Hungarian delegation that Hitler was meeting up in the mountains with his dogs and what have you.
You know, the other thing, just by watching the American History Channel, I think it is, you know, they do a lot on Hitler. They have this multi-season series. And he was a massive drug addict because he had a personal doctor.
Yeah. We've talked about that.
Yeah. Just shooting him up with he had this cocktail of chemicals in his body constantly. Mm-hmm. He was a physical mess. Mm-hmm. Thank heavens he was a maniac and didn't listen to his generals.
Right. Oh yeah, no doubt. Well, you mentioned the Eisenhower resignation letter, which is infamous or famous for what he did there. But I also want to point this out. This was a British officer said to one of the folks as they were about to invade Utah Beach. He says, "Don't worry if you do not survive the assault. We have plenty of backup troops who will just go over you."
Over you.
And yeah. it's jocularly. So which this is one of the points that I think is important, is this use of humor in the face of dark times. It can be such a strong leadership skill. Very few people have the ability to do it and do it well. I think this guy clearly knew what he was doing to bring that up. I mean, I'm sure that there might be some people who were not amused by it, but that's not the first mention of use of humor that's not the only mention of use of humor in this story. It must come up three or four times. There must be three or four references to it.
Yeah. Yeah. It reminds me of the sign in the coroner's office. "Our day begins when yours ends." I mean, it's macabre, but geez, you'd probably go insane if you didn't have that.
What is the veterinary and taxidermy? Either way, you get your dog back, whatever. Yeah. So there you go. But Ron, we're up against our next break already. This is flying by. I hope we can make it through this piece because there's a lot here. I want to remind our listeners they can get hold of either one of us by sending an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Of course, the website is The Soul of Enterprise, where you can see show notes as well as previews to upcoming shows. We do have our Patreon channel, patreon.com/TSOE, where you can get the show commercial free as well as our bonus episodes that we record each week. That is sponsored by 90 Minds. Find a mind at 90minds.com. Also, our friends at Kiesel Consulting, kieselconsulting.com. That's K-U-E-S-E-L consulting.com. But right now, a word from our sponsors.
Follow Voice America at facebook.com/Voice America for juicy updates from your favorite radio shows and podcasts.
Have you ever listened to an online radio show that changed your life? I'm required to say that I have. Have you ever stopped listening to an online radio show because the commercials were mind-numbingly repetitive? Of course you haven't, because you're here right now. Look, you don't have to listen to me anymore. There's a commercial-free version of this show, and it only costs $10 a month. And for $15 a month, you get no commercials plus bonus content. Go to patreon.com/TSOE, subscribe now, and be free. You're worth it.
The reviews of Ron Baker and Paul Dunn's book, Time's Up, are in, and they are outstanding. AC says, "I highly recommend this book to others in my field and beyond. Britta L. says, I was even awake at 3 a.m. one morning, filled with all the amazing ideas swirling in my head. And some guy named Greg T. added, do not consider transitioning your business to a subscription model until you've read this book. Head over to timesupclub.com, click on the book to purchase it, and while you're there, why not join at the free forever level and get access to some extras? Do it now. You'll be glad you did.
Are you a fan of the soul of enterprise? Have you always wanted to demonstrate you could create a commercial that was better than what Greg Kite developed? Well, now is your chance. Ed, tell them all about it.
Ron and I are actively looking for new sponsors for the soul of enterprise, and we have big plans to grow the show. To learn more, send us an email to asktsoe@verisage.com and put sponsor in the subject line, and we'll send you over our latest sponsor pack. We would love for you to be part of the TSOE team.
Streaming live, the leader in internet talk radio, VoiceAmerica.com.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Klass. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Well, welcome back, everybody. I'm along for the ride, but Ed's talking about project management insights from D-Day. It's the only PM show I've enjoyed, Ed. No, I'm kidding. One of the things I was kind of wanted to ask you about is in the Rumsfeld rules book, he says strategy, as I see it, has four steps. Set the goals. And then he talks about identifying your key assumptions. And I also want to ask you about assumptions, too, because that plays a huge role in this.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Determine the best course of action and then monitor your progress. And he's got a whole thing about metrics, but make sure it's the right metrics. But
right.
Set the goals. So I know you draw a distinction between goals and objectives.
Correct.
So tell me about the goals of D-Day versus the objectives of D-Day.
Yeah, the overarching goal of D-Day was to land on to establish that foothead, the beachhead, right? There probably were others, but let's leave it at that as the goal. And the reason why that is a goal and not an objective is because that is that to which we aspire but might not happen. I mean, Eisenhower has the letter of resignation in his pocket in case it doesn't happen. So it's clear that is something that they were aspiring to, but may or may not happen. Whereas objectives are the far more tangible things that we're going to do. We're going to land 125,000 troops. We're going to send up 15,000 planes. Those things would be the faked invasion, which we haven't gotten to into Calais. All of those would be objectives. The idea of objectives is if we do achieve the objectives, because they are more black and white, they're more yes and no Boolean, that if we achieve the objectives, then therefore we will meet the goal. It makes it more likely that we will meet the goal.
Right. Right. And if something unexpected happens, like Mike Tyson, everybody's got a plan until they're punched in the face.
Punched in the mouth. Right.
Then you can tweak the objectives.
Correct. Correct.
But do you ever, I would think sometimes too, you might tweak the goal, like
usually, but I think the answer was no. This is going to be a hard no.
That's true. This one was binary, but I would imagine there are situations where the aspirational goal can be lowered.
It could be. There could be an acceptable threshold, right? Which is probably what this was as well. Like, what does establish a beachhead really mean? A significant foothold. They probably had some thought process behind what that actually meant.
Right. Okay.
So when you're setting, because a goal has a probability of occurrence, what you can say is okay, if we meet it to a 90% expectation as of this date, that can be okay.
Okay.
And right.
And when I've heard you talk about PM, I know you talk about, constraints. Talk to me about assumptions, though. Mm. There was a lot of assumptions here that they were making.
Yeah. Simply speaking, assumptions are facts which you presume to be true.
Like the weather. They were delayed one day because of the weather.
One because of the weather, right. And facts which you presume to be true. And one of those facts was we need, or Hitler believed anyway, we need four days of clear weather. for this to happen. That was mentioned in the article. Now, they didn't know that because their weather forecasting wasn't that good as it is today. So they had to make some assumptions based on some previous weather data from previous years. They did delay because of a storm. D-Day would have been supposed to be originally June 5th. And that actually plays into the story later, which is the faked invasion into Calais and the ruse. But yeah, so that was a delay in D-Day because of it. But that was an assumption that we need clear weather. That's the assumption. Right. So that would be an example of that.
And I remember a story about Ike being told that the weather report would know it's going to clear up. It's going to clear up, but it wasn't 100% sure. And he had to make a judgment call.
Yeah.
And he said, we're going.
Yeah. Cause even on June 6th, it was a little sketchy too, dicey. But it, in the end, it turned out, I think, to their advantage, with one small exception. I don't know if we'll get there, but back to the project management piece, the one section here where it talks about the confusion over who had the right to move the Panzer divisions for the German side. Right. So in February of 44, Marshal Rudstedt, the commander of the army group, Rommel all had overlapping commands. Neither had command of the Luftwaffe or Kriegsmarine. So the anti-aircraft corps stayed under the control of Goering. So it was just this complete mess of matrix organization, if you will, of who's in charge of what. Meanwhile, Hitler's sleeping until 10 o'clock. And, they couldn't get him in there. So, yes, so that was a huge problem. I also thought this was interesting, is that the German high command or Hitler had blind faith in their defensive capabilities on the Atlantic wall. And this is from the man who easily outmaneuvered the Maginot Line 4 years earlier, right? Yeah, I mean, it's like one of those, you can't, what did you miss? Right about that. Okay, so the next thing, and this is at 1345, where they talk about Montgomery had earmarked Caen for capture in the first 3 days of the campaign, but did not fall until July 9th. This may be, and this might have been due in part to the bombing of the town, which gave the Germans ample opportunity to hide their machine gun's nest in the Rüffel. This is a great example of scope seep, right? Mm-hmm. Causing scope creep. Right. So the analogy isn't perfect, but my notion of scope seep is stuff that we do on our own because we think that that's what the customer wants. In this case, the bombing of the town, I don't know if that was necessary. And so what happened was, is they bombed this town with the idea is, okay, well, we're going to take this in the first 3 days of the campaign. So that's why we want to bomb it. But it created scope creep in the sense that, well, but it gave the Germans ample place to hide their machine guns in the rubble. So it's caused scope creep. So scope seep, doing something on our side, actually caused scope creep to occur to our against us. Right. So I thought that was a real, an interesting tie back in as well. I thought that the story, and I had not heard this about, de Gaulle, and I want to make this point. This is on June 4th. Churchill briefed de Gaulle.
Yep.
And de Gaulle says, I got some demands.
Yep.
And Churchill says, no, you really don't. And the ends up with Churchill or de Gaulle calling Churchill a gangster and Churchill calling de Gaulle a traitor and sending him back to his headquarters in Algiers in chains, if necessary. It's like, no, you don't get to dictate the terms here, Chuck. No, I'm sorry. you can't come here and say you have some demands at this point. But that happens in projects. That happens all of the time in projects. Like right just before you're about to, go live on something, there'll be somebody who had little to nothing to do with the project at all, and they'll be like, so we're gonna have to do this before. Who the hell are you? Like, what are you showing up here at the ninth, at the 11th hour saying that you have demands on stuff? And oh, by the way, this is going to help you in the end. So back to my Archie Bunker quote, shut up, you.
This is just somebody trying to stamp their legacy on a project, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, no, that was great. That was great. And it wasn't until the British Foreign Secretary Anthony Eden came in and brought some diplomacy. Churchill, he would have done it too, I'm sure.
Oh, I'm sure he would have. So in the next paragraph, though, I just love this little turn of phrase by this actress who was, I guess, sleeping her way to the top when the French occupied Paris. Collaboration horizontale. She was guilty of collaboration horizontale. Yeah, it's like, well said.
Can imagine what that. And the other thing, back to the deception thing that he points out, it was so successful. The Germans were continuing to reinforce Calais long after D-Day.
Yeah.
And of course, they put Patton in charge of it, which made the Germans, I think you said this in the first segment, but made the Germans think, well, they're not going to attack without Patton. So he's not going to be, you know, some deception.
It would be crazy to not have Patton be a part of this.
and an actor posing as Montgomery was sent to Gibraltar, which I thought was interesting as well. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They really did a great job tricking them out.
Oh yeah, no, it was. And like I said, this is all part of the plan for years and years and years and years ahead of time. And it made it so that they said the counterattacks were nothing compared to what they were expecting. And there's a great example of something not going according to plan that ends up in your benefit.
In your benefit, right. That's why the after action review says what went right and what went wrong. What were the good and the bad that came out of that? That unexpected, you know, the ground truth, if you will. Talk to me about constraints. What were the constraints here?
So constraints, again, these are barriers to completion. Obviously, the constraints are having, you know, Germans pouring in weapons at you. That's a constraint because we know what's going to happen. Right. So the way that I talk about constraints is like this. And you've seen like those American Gladiator shows, Ron, where, you know, there's they have to run through the obstacle course. Constraints are the obstacles, but notice that in all of those shows, those contestants know what the obstacles are going to be. They're going to have to, you know, go on the log that's spinning. They're going to have to crawl across the monkey bars or whatever. They're going to have to go up over a wall or climb up a greasy pole or whatever it is that they're going to need to do. So constraints are those things that we know about ahead of time. Now, sometimes constraints become can be also risks, but a constraint is just a fact. Like the German fortifications are constraints.
The weather
is a constraint. The weather is certainly a constraint, but the German fortifications being constrained, but you don't know here's a good constraint that you just brought up. There's going to be a counterattack. There's going to be one. Right. But the fact that it was significantly less than expected made it all the easier than on the Allies to continue forward, whereas they were expecting that to be a much more difficult challenge. Right. It's like the wall that somebody's got to climb over. And they're like, oh, I thought that was going to be a lot harder, but I got over that a lot quicker than I thought.
And in PM, a constraint could be on the client side, too. Right. They don't.
Yeah, sure.
Resources or.
Yes.
Talent or whatever.
Yes. And of course, time is a constraint, right? We've talked about that a lot. Time is a constraint. I mean, and here we saw this. Well, this is that we're going to do this within this day. Otherwise, we're pulling back.
Right.
So.
Awesome. All right. Well, Ed, we're up against the next break. And folks, I'd like to remind you, want to get a hold of me or Ed, send us an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Do go out to, rate this podcast /TSOE, and you'll be able to rate the show. And we do read all reviews on the air. And now, a word from our sponsors.
A little birdie told me Voice America is on X. Follow us at Voice America TRN.
The reviews of Ron Baker and Paul Dunn's book Time's Up are in, and they are outstanding. AC says, I highly recommend this book to others in my field and beyond. Britta L. says, I was even awake at 3 a.m. one morning, filled with all the amazing ideas swirling in my head. And some guy named Greg T. added, do not consider transitioning your business to a subscription model until you've read this book. Head over to timesupclub.com, click on the book to purchase it, and while you're there, why not join at the free forever level and get access to some extras? Do it now. You'll be glad you did.
Have you ever been so annoyed by a commercial for a $5 ebook that you were willing to pay $10 to never hear it again? I sure have. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. Over the last several years, you've come to hate me, and I hate me too. By now, you know that for $5, you can get a copy of Ron and Ed's book. What you might not know is, for twice that much every month for forever, you can stop hearing me plug Ron and Ed's book, which totally makes sense, like the Diamond Water Paradox. Go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe today. Please, for the love of God, make it stop!
Are you a fan of The Soul of Enterprise? Have you always wanted to demonstrate you could create a commercial that was better than what Greg Kite developed? Well, now is your chance. Ed, tell them all about it.
Ron and I are actively looking for new sponsors for The Soul of Enterprise, and we have big plans to grow the show. To learn more, send us an email to asktsoe@verisage.com and put sponsor in the subject line, and we'll send you over our latest sponsor pack. We would love for you to be part of the TSOE team.
The Internet's number one talk station. Number one talk station. VoiceAmerica.com.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using #AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
And we are talking about D-Day at 80, how the Allies won at Normandy and changed the history of the world. Before we get jumping in on this, we just want to remind people that we are collecting a lot of questions from people, from our listeners. So if you go out to thesoulofenterprise.com/questions or question, either one will take you there. You will be able to ask us a question that we plan to make a future show around. So go out there on any device with a microphone and you will be able to ask us your question. We will be able to download as an MP3 file and use it in a future show. Ron, I just wanted to finish up on this and talk about a couple things. One is something that I had forgotten I had remembered, which was that this Juan Pujol Garcia, the Spanish double agent who duped the Germans into believing he was running a network of no fewer than 29 sub-agents in Britain, even though all of them were fictitious. They called him the world's greatest actor. The Germans, and as you said, pointed out earlier, continued to reinforce Calais even long after it had been invaded. So I thought this was interesting. I've never been involved in an implementation where there was like a fake implementation going on the side. Right. We got a fake an implementation over here that slipped this one in on the end. So I don't have experience directly with that. But I do have the one thing that they mentioned is all diplomats in the weeks prior to the invasion were prevented from leaving Britain. There is a time getting close to an implementation when we got to lock everything down. You're not going to let anybody outside the room. But what you are going to say is things like, all right, no more changes. Like, no, the changes will happen, but they will happen after we make this transition. And then we will implement some new stuff for this. And that's fine. It's not like we're rejecting these outright. So it's a yes and, right? Yes, we will do that. But first we finish this.
That builds a home might have a punch list.
Right.
But still, let you move in.
Yes. Yeah. So that's exactly correct. So anyway, near the end of the article, he talks about Operation Overlord, which was the code name for D-Day, represents the single greatest service that the English speaking peoples ever rendered on civilization. Of course, and this is why this earns Eisenhower the Project Manager of the Century Award. He does get a little political at the end of the article, which I don't think we need to necessarily get into, except I just want to ask a couple of questions about this and link this back. And I know you want to talk a little bit more about Eisenhower, but would we have the stomach for this today?
He asks that. He talks about the greatest generation, and I have problems with the whole generation thing, because the guy sitting at home on his couch in Ohio was not, you know, on the beach in Normandy, but, you know, or in the drunk tank, as Jonah likes to say. But he does point out they knew what was worth fighting and dying for.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas today we seem to be unsure of everything, even down to the pronouns we should use for one another.
Mm-hmm.
That's a really interesting point. And I don't know, Ed. I mean, remember when we talk about Thomas Sowell all the time. Mm-hmm. But one of the things about Thomas Sowell was when on a Peter Robinson show, Peter asked him if he was optimistic or pessimistic. He said, "I'm pessimistic." He said, "If we were to be invaded, I don't think we'd fight back. We'd surrender."
Yeah. maybe. I mean, invaded is one thing. I mean, But my question is, so do we think the Chinese Communist Party has the stomach for this with regard to Taiwan?
I think they're like the Russians. They'll just throw bodies at it.
Yeah.
I see no evidence to the contrary.
Yeah. I just think there's a danger in looking at that as a monolith, right? Looking at that we assume that just because Xi shows this much power that he really has that over the people. And if once people start, especially, you know, the other thing that they're throwing here, China's one child policy. And now you're sending the sons and daughters of, and that's your only kid.
It's your only kid. Yeah. I know. I would hope there'd be an uprising, or even in the military, you know, stage a coup or whatever and disobey the orders. But I don't know. I don't see it. And I don't think we can plan on it.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think there's a knowledge of it either way.
But it's an interesting point.
Yeah.
I have had an article in my stack forever, How Ike Fought Anti-Semitism. This is from Jason Lancer in National Review from January 27th of this year. And he just talks about in April 45 when Eisenhower came face to face with the Holocaust. He was visiting a former salt mine turned depository for items looted by the Germans. He learned of a camp nearby the men had liberated a few days before. He was joined by Omar Bradley, George Patton. He arrived at APR, a subcamp of the nearby Buchenwald network, and Ike met with former prisoners. They toured every building and soaked in the hell camp. Eisenhower was shocked. He recognized his men, what his men were fighting against, and he issued a series of orders. The camps were to be documented, photographed, and filmed. Survivors were to be cared for and interviewed. He instructed all forces under his command to visit liberated camps. He ordered the German civilians from nearby communities to help bury the dead, care for the living, and see what had been done in their name. But he did even more than that. He called for and facilitated delegations comprising members of Congress and the British Parliament, newspaper editors, and other public opinion civic leaders to see the camps in person. He was just trying to document it for history. Mm-hmm. This happened. This is why we fought. You know, Reagan used to say, and he took a lot of flack for this, that he saw the camps liberated. He wasn't there physically. He got the films that they filmed because he was working in Hollywood, and that was one of his jobs, was to edit films, you know, narrate them and things like mm-hmm. that. And that's how he saw the Holocaust up close. He saw those films when they right. came in. And so I just thought that was really good thinking on Eisenhower's part to make sure that as many people as possible at the time saw this, including German civilians, press, all of that. I thought that right. was really cool.
Yeah, no, it definitely important that it is. And there's, I'm the name is escaping. I was trying to look it up, but there's a the movie that I just saw. Russ Roberts was talking about it, about the Nazi who lived next to next to Auschwitz. Really powerful. It's fantastic movie. So I'll try.
Did you see it?
I did.
Mm-hmm. You did. Yeah. No, I want to see that because it's just banal, right? I mean, it's just him with his family and his wife and the kids, and they don't even show the camp at all, hardly, right?
Right, right.
One thing. Yeah. I just think the premise of that is so powerful. Oh, geez. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's wild. Well, Ed, this was great. I'm glad you translated D-Day into project management for us. This is awesome. Maybe we should set up decoy projects so that idiot that comes in at the last minute, like the call and asks, yeah, fine, do it. Yeah, sure, we'll do that for you. To the decoy.
There you go. All right. All right. Now you convinced me, Ron. That might be a way around it. All right.
All right, Ed. What's up next week?
Next week, Ron, we are going to talk about one of our most the topics that is most often requested and also listened to on our previous shows, and that is the pricing third rail, price discrimination.
Right on. I'm looking forward to it. I'll see you in 167 hours. Been the soul of enterprise, business, and the knowledge economy. Join us next week, folks, on Friday at noon Pacific time. In the meantime, check us out at thesoulofenterprise.com. Greg will have full show notes up there about what we discussed today, including the article. And also, you can contact Ed or me at asktsoe@verisage.com. Thanks for listening, folks. Have a great weekend.